Dan Ordonson. Harika, duyuyorum. Bir sorun var mı senin kısmında? Aynen, birazdan. Başlamasını bekliyoruz oradan. Ben kanalları geçiş yaparım. Ha, bu arada senin numaran ne? WhatsApp'tan da yazışalım bir şey olursa. O zaman ben buradayım. Direkt alıyorum. Bana mic kapat geldi de. Sen numarayı söyle oradan devam edelim. Sonra hemen kapat.
Welcome everyone, and thank you to those joining us live and to those listening afterwards. I will also like to warmly welcome our guest today, who I will shortly introduce. Our webinar today is titled The Role of Pharmacists in the Prevention and Management of Periodontal Disease and Other Common Oral Health Conditions. We have roughly around 800 participants registered, but we know that not all of them will come and join us right now. They might just come and join us a bit later. So today is World Oral Health Day. This event will provide pharmacists with essential knowledge about periodontal disease by exploring the basics of the disease. We will discuss the relationship between oral health and non-communicable diseases, such as diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, and kidney disease, highlighting the need of an holistic approach to wellness. Evidence-based oral hygiene recommendations tailored for effective periodontitis management will also be explored. But first, let me introduce myself. My name is Luís Lourenço. I'm a community pharmacist, practitioner community pharmacist in Lisbon, Portugal, and I've been serving FIP as professional secretary since 2021. In our next slide, we will see our speakers. So for this event, we are joined by a panel of fabulous speakers, and I wanted to sincerely thank you on behalf of FIP, each one of them, for taking the time to prepare their presentations and to be here today. Some housekeeping announcements as well. As you can see on this slide, we have some announcements. Please note this event will be recorded, live streamed on FIP YouTube channel, and the recording will be available at events.fip.org. To all those listening, please feel free to send your questions through the Q&A box provided, and I will do my best to manage all the questions. So at the end, we will be able to address some of those questions. You are welcome to provide feedback to webinars@fip.org. I would also like to thank this opportunity to promote the benefits of the membership with FIP, including events and webinars. FIP is a global body representing over 4 million pharmacists and pharmaceutical scientists. You are a pharmacist or a pharmaceutical science or a pharmaceutical educator, and you would like to join and become a member, please register on FIP's website at fip.org. For this event today, we have the Turkish Pharmacists Association, one of the FIP member organizations, offers a Turkish translation. So it's available on Zoom by clicking on the translation icon, as you can see in this image. Now, let's move forward to our program today. Well, it's very self-explanatory, as you can read. We will start with a welcoming introduction by myself. Then we'll give the floor to Professor Philippe, who will focus on oral health basics, what do pharmacists need to know about periodontal disease. Then you move to another presentation, which has been recorded, so Dr. Zehra won't be able to join us today, but she has kindly sent us a video recording. She will focus on the relationship between oral health and systemic health and non-communicable diseases. And at the end, we have Asma Yonel from the School of Pharmacy, focusing on oral hygiene recommendations for the management of periodontal disease. Although you can already start writing your questions on the Q&A box, and the speakers will try to answer them throughout the presentations, but we will have some time to discuss them at point number 5, and then there'll be a wrap-up and conclusions and some announcements as well for FIP further events. Now, there are a number of learning objectives for webinars. When attendees will learn about, while gaining essential knowledge about the basics of periodontal disease, including its causes, progression, and key indicators to enable pharmacists to recognize and effectively manage this oral health condition, explore the relationship between oral health and non-communicable diseases, and explore oral hygiene recommendations specifically designed to effectively manage periodontitis. So with no further ado, I would like to introduce our first speaker. We'll be presenting on oral health basics, what do pharmacists need to know about periodontal disease. So Dr. Philippe Bouchard is dental surgeon and emeritus professor at Université Paris Cité Rothschild Hospital, APHP France, periodontist, member of the European Commission expert panels, past president of the periodontal research group at the IIDR, FDI Global Periodontal Health Project. It's a great pleasure to have you with us today, and so the floor is yours. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. May I? Okay, good. Hello everyone. Thank you for inviting me to present what do pharmacists need to know about periodontal disease. First of all, after the classic slide indicating that I have no conflict of interest, we'll do a quick reminder. Dentists treat two main types of disease, dental caries and periodontal disease. And periodontal disease, it's okay. A tooth is made up of a visible part, the crown, and a non-visible part, the root. The pulp, a cavity with a vascular nervous bundle, is covered by dentin, protected by a richly mineralized tissue, the enamel. What is the periodontium? The periodontium is everything but the tooth. It comprises four structures: gingiva, cement, ligament, and alveolar bone. The ligament is the tooth attachment system to the jawbone, as you can see from this histological section. Here you see the periodontal ligament and the root, and here the alveolar bone. The alveolar bone is covered by the gingiva, which is richly vascularized. This rich vascularization forms a communication network between the periodontum and the rest of the body. As you can see here, you can see on this histologic section, you can see the rich vascular network. Well, the alveolar bone the teeth is bathed in saliva, which contains bacteria in free form. These bacteria quickly adhere to surface and organize themselves in microcolonies or biofilm to form dental plaque. In a state of health, there is homeostasis, meaning a balance between good and bad bacteria. Gingivitis, in the first stage of periodontal disease, corresponds to clinical inflammation of the gums due to the accumulation of supragingival plaque. Clinically, it is most often characterized by bleeding when brushing. Gingivitis is highly prevalent, affecting around about 50% of individuals worldwide. Although the onset of dysbiosis dysbiosis can be observed at this stage, meaning a bacterial imbalance in favor of the pathogens. Gingivitis is reversible, meaning that once treated, it returns to its original state of health. Periodontitis, the second stage of periodontal disease, corresponds to the loss of root bone attachment, allowing the accumulation of subgingival plaque. Bone retraction is observed, and the situation is not reversible at all after treatment, meaning that the loss of bone cannot return to its healthy level. The prevalence of periodontitis is high, corresponding to 46% of American adults. To assess the extent of attachment loss, the practitioner used a periodontal probe with increments every millimeters. I can assure you that it's painless. And here you have the accumulation of subgingival plaque. Left untreated, severe periodontitis progresses to tooth loss. Now you understand why periodontitis has systemic consequences, as the bacteria in subgingival plaque are in direct contact with the gum. However, this is a subject for later speaker. Well, how can gingivitis be treated? Very easily, with scaling and oral hygiene instruction. Periodontitis is more complicated to treat. It is treated in the same way as gingivitis, but with addition of root planning using a curette. When periodontitis becomes severe, surgery may be necessary. This involves elevating a flap by separating the gum, then cleaning the tooth surfaces, and sometimes recontouring the bone. To put it in a nutshell, periodontal diseases are silent diseases. Prevention is the master word, and the aim is to prevent dental plaque accumulation. However, there are some symptoms that can be identified by the pharmacist by using short interviews: bleeding, tooth mobility, migration, gum retraction, bad breath, and also pain. Bleeding gums are not normal. If the gum is bleeding, keep brushing. After 3 days, if the gum is still bleeding, refer to the dentist. On the left, you can see a spontaneous bleeding, and on the right, the bleeding is provoked by the probing. Tooth mobility and migration. When a tooth is mobile and or tilted, this is not normal. If the tooth is mobile, refer to the dentist. Gum retraction. Do not indicate that you will lose the tooth, that the patient will lose the tooth. Reassure the patient. Often it is subjective. As a patient to track progress, take a picture with an iPhone, for example, initially, and another picture at 3 months. If the retraction increases, refer to a periodontist. Bad breath. If you had a bad breath, this is not normal. Brush your teeth, use OTC medicine, tongue scraper, stop smoking. Smoking is strongly associated with bad breath. After a week, if the patient still has bad breath, refer to a dentist. Pain rarely occurs in patients with periodontal disease. When pain is associated with bleeding, fever, nodes, patient must be referred to a dentist. Well, the pharmacists are at the forefront of oral prevention. There are two means of prevention: professional or individual. The common mean between professional and individual is oral hygiene information. Well, don't assume that all patients are informed. Above is a patient cleaning his teeth with a piece of wood. Here's the result. The teeth are clean, but the gums are terribly retracted. Below, a bipolar patient, during his manic episodes, he makes excessive use of interdental brushes and see the result. Well, there is no miracle method to convince the patient of the benefit of oral hygiene. Evidence-based approach is of little help to choose the best method to change patient behavior. But there are some rules. Do not judge the patient. Be on the patient's side. No barrier, table, gown, dental chair between the patient and you. Do not give the feeling that you delegate oral hygiene information and promote a healthy lifestyle. So this is exactly what we have with motivational interview, collaboration, not confrontation, etc., etc. Well, there are two approaches of the prevention that can be mechanical or chemical. Here you have the professional prevention. You all know what a scaling is, because I suppose that you go to the dentist once a year to have one. And when it comes to the individual prevention, tooth brushing is obviously the cornerstone. Well, some Q&A. Manual or electric? Well, this is a question. It is not so important, but if a patient does not brush adequately with a manual brush, the electric brush can be helpful. Should we use toothpaste? Yes, the use of toothpaste is useful to avoid rapid colonization of a root surfaces by bacteria. Are mouthwashes effective in everyday prevention? Yes and no. The most effective antiseptic used in mouthwash is chlorhexidine, but it has side effects and cannot be used for long. Interdental toothbrush, toothpick, dental floss, oral irrigators. Dental floss is recommended to prevent plaque accumulation between teeth in adult when the periodontum is healthy. If the patient has periodontitis, dental brushes are recommended. To conclude, pharmacists and dentists are both partners in the field of healthcare in general and oral care in particular. Then they must work together, because as I wrote in this issue of The Economist, periodontitis can increase the risk of type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular disease. The inflammation is chronic. Having periodontal inflammation is more than a cosmetic issue. The patient well-being is very much involved. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Philippe, for your insights and for sharing all that knowledge. We know that you're struggling with some flu. Just to thank you again for your efforts to be here today. So we give the floor now to our next speaker, which is Dr. Zehra Yonel. As I mentioned, this speaker's presentation will be on a pre-recorded video. So Dr. Yonel is a clinical lecturer and honorary specialist registrar in restorative dentistry at the School of Dentistry, University of Birmingham. her PhD is focusing on part of the doctoral research fellowship, explore the role of oral health team in the management of patients with type 2 diabetes. Dr. Zehra's research interest lies in the fields of epidemiology and the interface between oral and systemic diseases. So with no further ado, we give the floor, the virtual floor, to Dr. Zehra to have her pre-recorded video. Thank you.
Hello and welcome to this talk today by me, Zehra Yonel, a lecturer at the University of Birmingham. I have been asked to talk to you today about the relationship between oral health and systemic health, in particular non-communicable diseases. So a brief overview of today's talk. I have approximately 15 minutes today to speak with you about what is periodontitis, understanding the link between oral and systemic diseases, and integrating oral health into overall health strategies. So let's start with introducing periodontitis. Periodontitis is an inflammatory lesion mediated by host parasite interactions, and it results in the loss of connective tissue, the fiber attachment to the root surface, and ultimately to alveolar bone loss. It's what's colloquially known as advanced gum disease. And the burden of periodontitis is significant. There are significant psychological and social impacts associated with periodontitis, and we often have patients making comments to us regarding the appearance of their teeth and how it impacts on their mental health and well-being and their ability to socialize as they would normally have done so. There's also a significant financial impact, with periodontitis being responsible for almost 160 billion euros across Europe in 2018. But importantly, and what I'm here to talk about today, is the impact of periodontitis on the systemic inflammatory burden and systemic non-communicable diseases. And this is now very well documented. So let's start by understanding the pathophysiology of periodontitis. This is a wonderful cartoon by Professor Offenbacher, and it shows a cross-section through the tooth. Here we can see a tooth with the bacterial deposit building up on its surface. Unlike the gut mucosa or the skin, the tooth is a non-shedding surface. So unless this bacterial deposit is physically removed by either the patient or a healthcare professional, this bacterial biofilm will continue to grow and develop on the tooth surface. And what it does is it causes irritation and inflammation of the gums. And this in turn, if left unchecked in a susceptible population, will result in the subsequent destruction of bone. So what do we know? Periodontitis is a chronic non-communicable disease. It's characterized by inflammation, and if left untreated, will result ultimately in tooth loss. So here we have a picture of a patient who has healthy gums and teeth. If that patient allowed this bacterial deposit to build up on their tooth or teeth, they would have inflammation occurring, which resembles the picture you can see in front of you. Here we can see inflamed interdental papillae, a buildup of the bacterial deposit on the teeth adjacent to these areas of inflammation. And you can also see signs of spontaneous bleeding. These micro ulcers in the gingival tissues are key, as they allow blood and blood products such as neutrophils and white blood cells out to target the bacterial biofilm. But as you'll see later on, they're also key in the theoretical plausibility for the association between oral health conditions and systemic health conditions. Now, if left unchecked, this inflammation in susceptible populations will continue to not only involve the gingival tissues and connective tissue, but also the underlying bone. And then you get the bone retreating back, and you get the appearance here of loss of interdental bone, dark spaces between the teeth, and exposed root surfaces. Over time, if enough bone is lost, you will have drifting of the teeth will become wobbly, and eventually tooth loss will occur. So how are oral conditions linked with systemic conditions? Well, we think that approximately 60 systemic conditions have now been linked with periodontitis. And back in 2014, Professor Ian Trappell wrote an editorial for the BMJ talking about how it was time to take periodontitis seriously. And on the back of this going forward, this has certainly been the case, with the association between several conditions, such as diabetes and cardiovascular disease, becoming more noted in the literature. And certainly here we can see the International Diabetes Federation and European Federation of Perio came together in order to develop joint guidelines and consensus statements in 2017. Likewise, the World Heart Federation and European Federation of Perio came together in order to develop joint statements and guidelines relating to periodontitis and cardiovascular disease. And this took us full circle from Professor Trappell's editorial in 2014, where he used the title Time to Take Gum Disease Seriously, through to this Economist white paper, which used the same title and looked at the societal and economic impact of periodontitis in its own right. So given that 60 odd conditions have now been linked to periodontitis, is an association plausible? Simply, yes, I think it is. And I think it goes beyond shared risk factors. And it all goes back to this initial diagram, where we mentioned these small ulcers or micro ulcers in the salpicular epithelium of the gingival tissues. And we mentioned how they allow neutrophils and blood products out in order to try and tackle the bacterial biofilm that builds up on the adjacent tooth surface. But what is also important to consider is that these micro ulcers can act as a revolving door, also allowing the bacteria and their products in to the systemic circulation. And what can happen is as the periodontal bacteria enter the circulation following brushing the teeth, eating, oral hygiene procedures, and usual oral function, that bacteremia induces an acute liver response, resulting in increased systemic markers of inflammation, such as C-reactive protein. And that bacteremia activates systemic markers, including cytokines, reactive oxygen species, and neutrophils. Now, we talk about those micro ulcers, which suggests that they're small. And individually, they are. But cumulatively, they're approximately the same size as the palm of your hand, 5 square centimeters. And you can imagine how if an ulcer that was the size of the palm of your hand was in imminent and close proximity to a significant microbial biofilm, that could have an impact on your systemic well-being. So now that we've considered some of the ways that oral health may affect systemic health, let's think about how we can integrate oral health into overall health strategies. So as mentioned, there are several conditions which have been associated with periodontitis. To my mind, those conditions with the strongest evidence base are diabetes and cardiovascular disease, with strong evidence now also for chronic kidney disease. Here in the UK, we have a consensus statement called Making Every Contact Count, which we refer to as the MEC statement or MEC agenda. And this is a statement that was brought together by several large organisations, the NHS, Public Health England, NICE, the National Institute of Health and Care Excellence, endorsed this agenda, and they are the body responsible for driving UK healthcare policy, alongside all of these other major organisations responsible for healthcare in the United Kingdom. And what this agenda looks at is working together over millions of interactions that we as healthcare communities, pharmacists, dentists, physiotherapists, nurses have with our population of patients to induce a behaviour change by modifying behavioural risk factors. And we can do this by targeting the key risk factors that affect all or many non-communicable diseases. And these are use of tobacco, hypertension, alcohol consumption, living with overweight or obesity, and being physically inactive. And the approach is quite simple. As allied healthcare professionals, we have millions of interactions with patients and the public every day. So it's our opportunity to make a positive healthcare change. And we can do this through the opportunistic delivery and a consistent message regarding healthy lifestyles to enable patients to engage with their own healthcare and to make correct and appropriate life and health choices. And what we want to do is maximize the opportunity that we have within our routine interactions to briefly discuss health and well-being factors with our patients and public. And this really shouldn't take long. There's evidence now to suggest that a very brief interaction of only a matter of minutes is enough to have a significant impact due to the sheer numbers of patients and public that as allied healthcare professionals we're seeing on a day-to-day basis. So why is it so relevant? Well, the MEC agenda aligns really nicely with both the United Nations vision to reduce premature mortality from non-communicable diseases by a third by 2030. And they want to do this through prevention and treatment. But also the World Health Organization has acknowledged that non-communicable diseases kill 41 million people a year. And that's about three quarters of all of global deaths. So if having these brief interactions is something which enables us to make a significant impact, it's certainly something that must be considered. So as mentioned, cardiovascular disease, cancer, respiratory diseases, and diabetes are responsible for approximately 80% of all premature deaths related to non-communicable diseases. And they all share the same risk factors: smoking, hypertension, alcohol consumption, living with overweight or obesity, and also sedentary lifestyles or physical inactivity. And all of these risk factors are also risk factors for periodontitis or oral health. So there's a real opportunity here as oral healthcare professionals and allied healthcare professionals to be speaking with our patients to make sure that we not only improve their physical health, but also their oral health as well. And this is where I believe we as allied healthcare professionals can come in. MEC is all about risk factor management. And even though we know that the association between oral health and systemic health goes beyond shared risk factors, this is an easy area for us to target as allied professionals, as we know what medications people are taking. So we know if they have a history of diabetes or cardiovascular disease or chronic kidney disease, and therefore may be susceptible to oral health problems and vice versa. We can therefore signpost patients to relevant services, whether that's medical settings, dental settings, or pharmacy settings, in order for patients to get the most appropriate advice. For example, oral health awareness by pharmacists or to patients collecting diabetes and cardiovascular disease medications. If patients are walking into pharmacies asking for these medications, it's an opportunity for brief oral health advice to be given. Likewise, in the UK, there's ongoing studies looking at dental teams referring patients with periodontal problems to their GP to assess for potential of undiagnosed diabetes. There's also an opportunity upon diagnosis of diabetes and cardiovascular disease that medics can inform patients of their oral healthcare risk. Here you can see there's greater opportunity for integrated health working. There are also some excellent resources available for pharmacists, such as these dental fact sheets. These are resources that enable pharmacists to give clear and concise information to patients regarding oral health problems, such as mouth ulcers, abscesses, tooth decay, and oral pain. So in summary, periodontitis is a severe form of gum disease, which if left untreated results in lost teeth and the subsequent challenges there, both psychologically, socially, and functionally, that patients may suffer. It's strongly associated with diabetes and cardiovascular disease, in addition to at least 55 other systemic conditions. We know that there are several shared risk factors between oral health conditions and systemic conditions. And we know that the association between these systemic conditions and oral health problems go beyond shared risk factors. There's evidence in the UK that brief intervention for behaviour change can be both clinically and cost effective. And we know there is scope for greater integration of working and closer collaboration amongst allied health professionals. I'd like to thank you for taking this time to listen to my talk. And sorry, I can't be with you in person today, but I would welcome any questions and do feel free to contact me either via email or via Twitter, and I'll be sure to respond. Thank you again for this opportunity.
So this was a presentation of Dr. Zehra. While we have the opportunity to address, all of you have the opportunity to address some questions as her contacts were shared. And I will move forward for our third and last presentation for today. Will be actually run by our colleague Asma Yoyuish, she's a part of the team developing the pharmacy programs within the College of Medical and Dental Sciences at University of Birmingham, both undergraduate and postgraduate. Asma is a non-medical prescribing pharmacist who is still actively practicing in a general practice. She's enthusiastic about promoting medicine's adherence and has a specific interest in involved in advanced role of community pharmacists. Asma is keen on developing interprofessional working, teaching and learning practices. Other areas of interest include prescribing pharmacy roles, evolving role of pharmacy and GP practices, and evolving community pharmacy services. Asma, thank you so much for taking the time to be here with us. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Thanks for inviting me today to the event, and it's a pleasure here to talk to you about oral hygiene recommendations for the management of periodontal disease from my perspective as a pharmacist. So probably in the next few slides, you'd realize that I'm putting points together really from the two talks that we've listened to so far and put in some of the practical elements that we can be involved in as pharmacists. So by the end of this presentation, I'd hope I would have covered some of the oral hygiene practices that are essential for managing periodontal disease, the role of pharmacists in oral health education, how we can integrate this in our routine patient care, and have a bit of discussion about how we can work with other healthcare professionals to have a holistic approach to periodontal disease management. So, as has already been highlighted in previous presentations, managing periodontal disease involves a combination of both professional treatment and a good oral hygiene practices at home. As a pharmacist that worked previously in community settings, currently working in primary care and have contacts and experience in hospital pharmacy, we can see that we've got plenty of opportunity through patient contact to give advice around the good oral hygiene. Sometimes you probably spot a patient that is actually walking around in your pharmacy, looking at some of the oral hygiene products, wondering what to pick up or looking for a particular one. They might actually come and ask you directly for help and advice. And we should be in a good position and quite knowledgeable about giving advice about brushing at least twice a day, using a fluoride toothpaste and a soft toothbrush, gently in a circular motions to remove plaques. We should be able to advise patients about flossing, and that is to remove any food residues or any bacteria, as highlighted in previous slides, that might accumulate between the teeth that cannot be reached by the toothbrush. Patient might want advice on antibacterial mouthwashes to help reduce plaque and gingivitis causing bacteria, and we usually look at those that contain antibacterials. At this point, what I would like to highlight is that actually it's beyond advising, because we're probably going to do many interviews to actually explore the patient views, the patient expectation and concerns. Why is the patient looking for a specific product? Why would they like to change their product? As highlighted in the very first presentation by Professor Philippe Bouchard, sometimes some of the symptoms that the patient is coming into the pharmacy for are actually quite alarming and maybe would need referral to a dentist. If they've got bleeding gums for a long time, if they've got a toothache, if they've got bad breath, you might advise them about the possible causes of these symptoms in reference to periodontal diseases. You might ask them to take pictures, as suggested by some of by one of the slides earlier on, and to help them sort of monitor the progress and give them advice as you go along. As healthcare professionals, we're very well placed to advise patients on public health matters, and we're expected to do this in our daily job. So we could be, it doesn't matter what settings you're working in, you have endless opportunities to advise patients about smoking, about healthy diet, stress management, and obviously the big sort of area that we take pride of, which is medication. Now, what we have to start sort of thinking about as pharmacists is that seeing this really in the bigger picture. So grasp every opportunity that comes in our way to talk about patients, those topics, which we might do when we're reviewing patients for chronic diseases, when reviewing patients for their medications. But we have to get into the routine of talking and incorporating good oral hygiene within those. I'm hoping with the very first two presentations, we've got a better understanding to how come smoking and diet contribute to periodontal diseases. And sort of we can focus on mentioning those as well as the other problems that patients might develop because of their smoking habits or their diet, as well as stress management. In terms of medication, we're aware that there is a number of medication that might lead to dry mouth, that might cause dental problems, making the patient aware of this, allowing the patient to understand how their medication works, how could they go around those side effects. For example, if a patient is suffering from dry mouths, you might sort of advise them to suck on boiled sweets or have a sugar-free chewing gum to try and promote the saliva in their mouth. You can offer them some of the products that are available in terms of a saliva replacement, sprays, or sweets. And you are a trusted source of a healthcare professional that you should be able to refer your patient to professional cleaning. So you've always got to reiterate to the patient, despite all the conservative measures they'll do and that we expect them to do at home, they still have to visit their dentist at least once a year to get their teeth cleaned professionally. What Professor Philippe Bouchard referred to as scaling. They need to have regular dental checkups as recommended by their dentist. Some would need once a year, some would need more than that. And they've got to follow the treatment plan that is advised by their dentist. And the message to take away from this slide is what Dr. Zehra, Yonel referred to, is that every encounter matters and every opportunity matters. Sometimes it could be a lengthy conversations, but sometimes a brisk 30-second message could stick with the patient and could make an impact. So we do play a crucial role in educating patients, and we do that on so many different levels and conditions about their medications, about their health problems. And we are in a good position to educate patients about oral health practices and how to prevent those periodontal diseases or manage them. And the key things into our education to our patients is we have to think about our communication strategies. We have to have in place clear messages, a concise language that patients would understand, would find simple, avoid using the jargon. We've got to listen to our patients. And that's the key in a two-way communication or in motivational interviewing, as highlighted by Professor Philippe Bouchard, is that you have to understand what are your patient concerns, what are their expectations, what are their priorities. And that would allow you actually to tailor the advice and the recommendations to what suits them and might work better. You might find it useful to use visual aids. So if you've got diagrams, models, videos to demonstrate like the brushing or flossing techniques, some fact sheets about untreated periodontal disease and the consequences of that. And we have to be mindful that each advice is fit for a patient depending on their medical conditions, comorbidities, their age, and their current oral health status itself. So be reasonable about the advice provided. Obviously, in patient counseling, we have to develop ourselves and be confident into recommending product, into understanding the difference between toothpaste that are available, which ones that we should be recommending. Why do we have so many of them on the shelves? Similarly, it goes to the mouthwashes, understanding the interdental brushes versus the flossing lines and how those are different, which ones would be better suited for which patients, and understanding your specialized products, for example, products that are used for dry mouth. You might sort of consider the lifestyle factors. So you might want to talk to your patient, take a bit more history about your patient, their smoking, their diet, their lifestyle in general, and explore those and try and link those to oral health in your conversation and see sort of try and get the patient to understand how do those link to each other and how actually trying to make change and a behavioral change would be beneficial at all levels. So this slide is a bit crowded, but it's really to talk about those opportunities. And the very first one would come through your routine medication reviews. So you would do that whether you're working in primary care, whether you're discharging a patient from a hospital, whether you're actually in a community setting reviewing your patients. And as part of a medication review, sort of you would still be exploring lifestyle, smoking habits, and general sort of diet for the patient. And it's your opportunity to explore any oral health advice that you can provide to your patient, even if it's generic to that patient, or it could be very specific because they've got medication that causes dry mouth or medication that is meant to be causing dental problems. You have to integrate it into your chronic disease management, as Dr. Zehra Yonel highlighted too. So when you're seeing your diabetic patient, patient on hypertension, cardiovascular problems, respiratory problems, having a discussion or making it a routine within your conversation to discuss oral health is very important. And that's your opportunity to approach the topic. We do run campaigns, a lot of public health campaigns, and as part of those, you can either provide patient education material, so you might have leaflets about the signs and symptoms of periodontal disease and be able to speak to patient about it. You might have leaflets about the appropriate technique of toothbrushing, flossing, education around mouthwashes and about general health and lifestyle. Some of the public health could involve demonstration and workshops. So you might have a corner in your pharmacy where you've got a desk with one of your team members that is able to have some material in front of them, could run a live demonstration on brushing teeth, important of flossing, talking to patients about different lifestyle changes that will have an impact on their oral health. Some pharmacies will offer health screening and assessment, and you might be screening patients for hypertension or diabetes or high cholesterol levels, or you've got an asthma clinic that you run. And within those clinics and health screenings, you should make it a routine practice to discuss with patients their oral health and their habits, and seek the opportunity to give them an advice, no matter how brief is that advice is. Follow up and monitor your patients. So sometimes you would be in a position to refer the patient directly because you think the matter needs urgent attention by the dentist. But if the problem might have just started, like Professor Philippe Bouchard highlighted too, they might have just noticed the bleeding in their gum just yesterday, and they're coming to the pharmacy for maybe they think they need to change their toothbrush, or it could be the toothpaste. So having that open conversation about what could be the potential causes of bleeding, but as well to follow them up, what happens after 3 days or a week, if that hasn't improved, if that hasn't stopped. And working with dental professionals. So be very well aware of the other healthcare professional teams, especially dentists, and the support they can give you. So they might run some of the health campaigns with you. They might be able to provide you material that you can use. They might be able to offer a training session to you and your staff so that you're actually more knowledgeable and more confident to provide support to your patients. And that takes me to the holistic approach, really, to periodontal disease, which has been already discussed and talked about in the previous two presentations. And obviously, we're talking and we're saying pharmacists and dentists, but you could be closely working with nutritionists and dietitians, especially when you've got a range of elderly patients with a dry mouth that could be medication induced, that could be age related, but sometimes they're under the nutritionist or dietitian specialist, and having working collaboratively with those into advising patients on the relevant diet. Some others, they might support them with diet that is not so good for their teeth, for their oral hygiene, and in general wouldn't have been good for their health. So it helps and support them to change their lifestyle. I've already talked about dentist and pharmacist collaboration, and so working closely with the dentist within your community or within your practice or within your hospital, so that you're up to date with the recommendations, up to date with what is available as product, as resources that helps you to support your patients. Primary care providers, so you could be either a pharmacist yourself working in primary care, or you could be working in the community, but you need to be working closely with your primary care providers. Sometimes as a primary care pharmacist, you might be running different clinic and consultations. Myself as a prescriber, I do, and you would come across patients where you would need to talk to them about healthy lifestyle, about I couldn't actually think of a patient that you wouldn't talk to about this. It's just the extent that you would go to defense on the patient and then profile. But those are the opportunities that should be taken to work interprofessionally to improve patient care by referring to them to their dentist if needed to, by seeking help and advice from your dentist yourself. I mean, the dentist that you work with, so that you can provide the correct information to your patient. So that takes me to the end of my slides. And what I would say is every opportunity counts. The footfall of patients into pharmacies is huge compared to other healthcare professionals, especially in the community settings. No appointments are required, longer opening hours, and patient might come to you for at least the initial advice, and you should be in a position to support them and lead them in the right direction. Thank you for listening, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Asma, for your presentation, for sharing so many insights about the daily practice of pharmacists and how can actually interact with other healthcare professionals. And so with your presentation, we finished the presenting part of this webinar and we move forward to the questions. We are receiving a lot of good feedback overall for all speakers. So congratulations on that. The participants are very happy and very informative session. But in the meantime, we have collected a couple of questions I would like to share with you. Then we have here from our members, from our participants, and maybe this question will go to Professor Philippe. Well, people are asking if the toothpaste should be fluoride or non-fluoride. And there's also some questions about if periodontitis and gingivitis affect children and how can prevent the same issues to be actually on that stage. What should be the procedures to follow regarding children and about their oral health? And after we have these questions answered, we move forward to asthma. So, Professor Philippe, the floor is yours.
Oh, thank you very much. Can we go step by step? The first question about fluoride. It's absolutely mandatory. Fluoride in the toothpaste, all the studies that we have actually now support the use of fluoride in toothpaste. So, and this is a big problem, for instance, in some countries, because some people, ecological people, they say, don't use fluoride, it can be bad. No, there is no side effect with fluoride. Of course, if you use fluoride with an adequate quantity of fluoride in the toothpaste, and now all the toothpaste are excellent in terms of dosage of the fluoride. So please, please use fluoride. This is a very, very important point. You do not protect the periodontium with the fluoride, but you protect the individual against dental caries. The second question was, can you tell me?
Enough? Yes, about children and how we can prevent gingivitis and what should be the procedures. And for instance, at what age shall we start having children being taking care of their teeth?
Yeah, brushing. I mean, you know, how to prevent children from gingivitis. It's very easy. Brush your teeth if you are the mother or if you are the father. Brush your teeth with the children, because the children, they want to imitate their parents. And this is very important for the parents. Sometimes the parents are running you with the children, please brush your teeth, brush your teeth. Doesn't matter. It doesn't mean anything. Brush your teeth and the children, they will imitate the parents. That's a key question. There was another question about the use of dentifrice in children. Of course, you can use dentifrice in children, and you must use dentifrice in children, fluoride dentifrice for children. And there was a question about the young children, babies. Yes, you can use it. If you have, of course, you need the baby needs to have the teeth, but you can the mother can use dentifrice on his not with a brush, but with her finger and to doing a massage around the on the gingiva around the teeth. So. Another question?
So if I may, Professor Philo, I'm just move forward to asthma so I can give you some time just to relax a little bit because there's a lot of questions coming towards you, but you also have some from asthma. So asthma, well, you have shared a lot of experience, well, your insights about the collaboration with other healthcare professionals. But the cornerstone is the knowledge of pharmacists about oral health. We are now promoting it a little bit with this webinar, and hopefully with more when you spread it throughout our network. But from your experience, what are the barriers to the pharmacist to leverage their expertise in oral health hygiene and periodontal diseases?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because we can sort of sit and talk about how ideal it is to do all of those, but certainly things do come with challenges that we need to be aware of and try to mitigate. And I think one of them is the limited time and resources, especially in community settings. So, and that's why I kept saying throughout the presentation, it could be even a 1 minute, it could be even a 30 seconds, it could be a two words advice that matters. But for sometimes for an extended piece of advice, for a good education to the patient, you need to allocate the time. And you will have often very limited time during the patient consultation, which make it a bit hard to approach all the topics, including oral health. The other problem obviously come with resources. So if you haven't got enough staff available to help you manage the rest of your role and your duties and responsibilities, then obviously that this is where you're probably looking into cutting corners, and probably you wouldn't be able to give the patient the advice that you'd love to, or give them the time and the dedication to explore their concerns and worries. Another sort of thing that might some of my colleagues agree with me and is the lack of formal training. So some pharmacists would perceive that they are the expert in medicines, they've been trained to do so, but they don't consider themselves as the expert in oral health, which might sort of hinder them from putting themselves forward to provide the patient with this advice, or to be able to open the conversation with patients. So without that specific training, so that they're not willing to do so, but this could be overcome probably by, as we did today, and a lot more in terms of educating pharmacists around oral health, working in collaboration with other healthcare professionals, mainly dentists, to have a better understanding. And probably it goes back into the education and training at the level of pharmacists being at university. Probably patient awareness and interest as well. So probably patients see that the pharmacist is not the best person to speak to about oral health, it's rather the dentist. So they might not really come to you, to the pharmacist, to ask for that particular advice. And even if they've got the shelves with the products, they just perceive it as to pick and pay for, rather than knowing that they'd be able to ask the pharmacist and have the confidence in the pharmacist to give them this some oral advice. And as it comes with everything else, really, is the finances and incentives as well. That could be a barrier to the pharmacist using that expertise, because there is a lot of pressure to deliver services. So is your service about health screening, like I mentioned earlier, to try and keep like case finding hypertensive patients or running an asthma clinic? As much as you would love to approach and have a holistic approach, the focus is still to how many patients can you see, how many patients can you review, which put a constraint on the time and the willingness to provide patient with oral health. So those are things that we've got to consider in the wider picture of the pharmacist putting themselves forward to be part of this campaign to prevent periodontal diseases. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Azra. Very important points that you shared. A lot to be done, actually. And now I'll give the floor again to Professor Philippe, who have a lot of questions coming. So I'm going to divide this in two. So the first part will be focusing on toothpaste, and the second part focusing on mouthwash. So regarding toothpaste, we have some questions about the impact of the whitening toothpaste, if they are advisable or not, if the charcoal toothpaste are also good for health or not. And and that's it from now. Then I'll go through to the mouthwash. Thank you.
Yeah, first of all, whitening is not very dangerous. It is absolutely dangerous if you make many, many whitening. It does if you are not reasonable. But normally, when a dentist advised to whitening, but you have to think that whitening has some limitations, meaning that if there are stinks on the enamel, that's not good. That's not sufficient. You will need prosthetic dentistry. Just a remark about, I love the talk of Asma Yayush when she said that the pharmacist plays a crucial role in oral health education. This is my opinion. The pharmacists are really, really important in the medical field in oral health. This is very important. Yeah, and the second question was?
About mouthwash. So we have a couple of points to be clarified. So how often should we use mouthwash? It's compulsory every day. You mentioned also that chlorhexidine is the most efficient, or the mouthwash with chlorhexidine are more efficient, but they do have side effects. So participants are asking, what are those side effects? And if it makes any point to use mouthwash with antibiotics or antibacterial. And and that's it. I'm collecting all of them.
Antibiotics, no, not at all. Mouthwash or whatever, I don't know in different, because we are talking in different countries. For instance, in Europe, pharmacies they are not allowed to deliver antibiotics without prescription. But the use of antiseptics in the mouthwash is recommended. But you have to keep in mind that the best antiseptic is chlorhexidine, and chlorhexidine has many side effects. Number one, there is a coloration of the teeth. Number two, there are a lack of tasting. Many side effects. This is the reason why do not give chlorhexidine mouthwashes to the patient. This is really, really limited to the period after a surgical procedure, for example, for 15 days, no more. But you can use some mouthwashes on a daily basis. You tell the patient that if the taste, they have problem with the taste, they have to stop the mouth rinse. But otherwise, there is no specific problem.
Thank you so much. So, taking the opportunity that you are answering some questions about periodontitis, there are some questions about the relationship between periodontitis and Alzheimer's disease. I don't know if there is a link, and also dry eye syndrome. And there's also a question about the fact that some athletes might have some oral health issues that are slightly different from the rest of the ordinary people. Is there any evidence about this, about the fact that we have high performance athletes having some issues with oral health? So those would be the questions for now.
This is a question for asthma, no?
No, that's for you. That's for you, Professor. That's for you. Sorry. I'll give you asthma another one in a minute.
First of all, what you have to keep in mind is that association is not causation. That's completely different. This is not because you have an association that you have a causation. For instance, you have a bilateral association between diabetes and perio. But perio doesn't cause diabetes, and diabetes doesn't cause periodontitis, and the same for cardiovascular diseases. So, and the same for everything. If you want to find an association, the good example is the cancer. We have had some studies showing that there is an association between cancer and periodontitis. But this year, very recently in 2023, we have had a Mendelian randomization showing that there is no association at all. So what we can say right now is that there is an association, strong association, independent association between diabetes and perio, between cardiovascular disease and perio. That's all. All the other, Alzheimer is very, let's say, exciting area of research because you do not have treatment. And if ever we had the opportunity to find a oral bacteria such as Porphyromonas gingivalis or AA or these bacteria, very aggressive, and we have found in a brain abscess, we have found the migration of this bacteria in brain abscess. Yes, but no, there is no, there is a very weak association, but no more. Regarding the question about athletes, there was a question, that was a very interesting question. Why? Because they can use probiotics. And the probiotics can help in modifying the oral microbiome by increasing the population of beneficial bacteria and decreasing the population of the bad guys, the pathogenic bacteria. On top of that, they have anti-inflammatory properties. But maybe this is, I say maybe because I am not specialist of athletes, but maybe the anti-inflammatory properties of the probiotic may be something that should be avoided with the athletes. And also, the probiotic can enhance the host immune response against periodontal pathogens. And it also, but this is not for the athletes, it's promote the wound healing after the surgery. And on top of that, the probiotic, they can reduce the presence of malodorous bacteria in the oral cavity, so they can fight the bad breath. Well, probiotic, but keep in mind that the cornerstone of any treatment of periodontitis is tooth brushing. And this is the reason why the pharmacists are so important, because they are here to give the advice, to give the good material, etc., etc.
Thank you so much, Professor Phillips. Now I'll give the floor to Asma. We have a couple of questions here. So from your experience about, well, education, training, interaction, there's been some questions about if there are any materials available. We know that probably we do have locally or nationally. Just wondering if there is any resource center we can actually get more information for having our colleagues educated on this issue. That'll be question number one. And question number two, also deserve a question number two, we have here. So from your experience, in what ways pharmacists can collaborate with other healthcare professionals? We know that all of us are very busy. You know, very experienced of having people sharing information, healthcare professionals sharing information. What are your thoughts on this? So can you actually give some tips for our colleagues locally and nationally just to enhance this partnership? So thank you, Asma, the floor is yours.
Okay, I think with the first question about education and resources, I think Dr. Zehra Yonel highlighted the dental fact sheets, which are available online and accessible regardless to where you are. It's sort of in general, for example, in the UK where we are, we've got the NICE, that stands for the National Institute of Clinical Excellence, that will have some guidelines and information about the management of periodontal diseases, and that will have usually advice to the patient. They can access the NHS websites for recommendations, and those are accessible regardless what country you are in, and those will usually actually provide advice to patients, which you can tailor then into sort of being accessible, because not every patient will have access to digital information, not every patient would know where to go and find the information. And actually that might link to the next question about collaborating with other healthcare professionals. This is where you would be able to get a lot more educational material if you work very closely with your local dentists. I sort of used to know every dentist that was around the area, because I do get prescriptions from those dentists to dispense to patients. But knowing them, then you'd be able to go and ask for resources, for information, and that's part of the collaboration. You can arrange events where you can invite dentists to come and do some training for a couple of hours over an evening, or they could be providing you with a small webinar where you'd be able to join and train and ask the questions that you need to ask, anything that you're not sure about, and the best way to advise your patients. Certainly with working with other healthcare professionals, sort of ideally I'd have loved if we have a shared electronic health record. So different countries have got different sort of, has gone to different levels really in that access. So from the UK point of view, sort of community pharmacists can access the summary care record of a patient. Dentists are not yet able to access the health record of a patient, but if we had the access to the health records, we would be able to see that a patient has got potential of developing periodontal disease because of their family history or because of what the dentist recommended in terms of their examination. We would be very mindful of this in terms of planning the patient medication or changes. We would be in a position to give advice about medication to be avoided or medication that has got potential side effects. You could be working throughout your medication review. So, and that's why it's very important to talk to the patient about their lifestyle, their health, their smoking habits, and approach oral health, because probably the patient is the best to tell you what the dentist have told them, what the problems they have. And while you're reviewing your patient, you're taking this into consideration in terms of what does the patient has got as other health conditions, what medications is good for them to stay on, what medication we need to work around, and educate them in general about the oral health. Be aware who to refer to and when. So work locally with the dental team around in your area, and be in a position to refer patient for them for access of care, so into what you think. So some places might have a referral system in place where if the pharmacist through a brief intervention realized that the patient needs specific dental care, they might put in a referral with few lines to the dentist, then that patient get picked up and followed up by their colleague. Again, it's patient education is very important. And I think this is where you would be working indirectly with other healthcare professionals, because you're supporting them through your education to your patients, using every single opportunity. And we have to bridge that gap in knowledge. So if we're not sure or we're not confident about oral health, then attending training, seeking training from the experts, but then being able to grasp every opportunity that comes your way to actually educate your patients. As Professor Philippe Bouchard said, it really starts from just toothbrushing. And just reiterating that message of regular toothbrushing, using the right toothpaste and the right toothbrush. That advice could go a long way if it was filtered in every encounter that we get, regardless of age as well. So it's the advice equally available to parents for their kids, for the kids that are old enough to understand the information. We get them coming in with their parents, and sometimes you've got those motivational toothbrushes with all sorts of characters in them, and they've got the minutes so they can brush their teeth for 2 minutes. I think pharmacists need to appreciate that. You'd be impressed how much a child might take the information from you, not from their parent, because they're just excited about being empowered, and you put them in that position to tell them this is what you need to do, and they look up to you as someone who knows what they're talking about. So all those opportunities, you're not directly working with other healthcare professionals, but you are, because you're educating the patients and you're reducing the healthcare burden. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Asma. Very informative. So the last two questions, and first a piece of information. We have received some messages from our participants regarding certificates, not only from this webinar, but from previous webinars. Any issues that you might have, please just send an email to webinars@fip.org. And then we'll have sorted out. And Professor Philippe, last but definitely not the least, we have an audience and pharmacists. So there's a lot of interest of our participants to know what sort of OTCs medicines, if there is are any OTCs medicines, and also prescription only medicines like antibiotics are used for treating periodontitis. If you can share, well, of course we know that it's a tailor-made approach for sure, but there has been some interest on this area, so the floor is yours. Thank you.
I'm not completely sure to fully understand the question. You're talking about what type of ETC or OTC we can use?
Yeah, the question is, while participants are asking, what sort of medicines can be used to treat periodontitis? For instance, if you use a regimen of antibiotics and painkillers, if it makes sense or not. So in a way, since we have an audience of pharmacists and you are very keen on medicines, we would like to know a bit more about the use of medicines in periodontitis treatment.
You know what? I think that antibiotics should not be used. Mm-hmm. It's very strange, even in my country, because the GPs in my country they have a gingivitis or they have a periodontitis, and the first step was to give antibiotics. It's absolutely stupid. Do you know why? Because antibiotics can save people. And antibiotics, giving, for example, amoxicillin or plus metronidazole to treat a periodontitis, and of course a gingivitis, it's crazy, but a periodontitis doesn't mean anything because you create resistance, and if you have resistance, you could have a very a fatal disease, fatal infection, and the antibiotics that doesn't work. They do not work. So I would say that please do not use antibiotics. And the antibiotics are used only if they normal treatment by elimination of the dental plaque, by surgery, etc., doesn't work. It happens sometimes. It's very rare, but it happens. In that case, you can use antibiotics. Regarding the other OTC, I think probiotics, you can use probiotics for the patient. That's not bad. And I'm not a specialist of this type of medicine because I treat the patients and really. Asma, want to
yes.
say something?
Oh, sorry, Professor. I was going to just intervene to say I'm not aware of over-the-counter medicines that is available to manage periodontitis, and I would personally not recommend it because beyond the explaining to the patient about the toothbrushing technique, exploring the use of antibacterial mouthwashes, the ones that contain antiseptics, and they need to be examined and they need to have a dental checkup. So we wouldn't encourage them. And I think whatever is available there, if there is any, there is little evidence or no evidence at all to back up the use of over-the-counter medicines. Going back to antibiotics, I think we've got another sort of badge on our shoulders, pharmacists, to preserve antibiotics and to we have the antibiotic stewardship where we actually need to use antibiotics very appropriately. And probably I've talked a lot about seeking training and advice from dentists so that pharmacists are a bit more knowledgeable about oral health and are confident, but we equally do training ourselves to dentists about the use of antibiotics. So if we had a lot of prescriptions coming from the same dentist, we'd usually have a conversation about what is the reason and what is the cause, really, because we try and minimize those. I'm hoping the audience from Professor Bouchard and Dr. Yonel presentation have gathered that periodontal disease is inflammatory in nature, not infective.
Exactly.
So you've got the plaque that has got bacteria sort of and food that builds up in it, and this needs to be removed either by proper brushing or by the scaling and the water flossing and some a bit of mechanical power, really, to get it off. But the problem itself is inflammatory, not infective, and therefore the use of antibiotics is completely inappropriate.
You know what? In the Journal of American Medical Association, the JAMA, the year before, they record all the specialties, physician of the, including the physician and the dentist. You know, the dentists are the best in the U.S. In the prescription of antibiotics. Is it normal? It's not absolutely. It's absolutely not normal, because the life of the patient, is not. It's a life-threatening disease, and we are the first in using antibiotics. It doesn't make sense for me. And in Europe, the two countries that are the most using antibiotics are Spain and France.
Well, that's very interesting to know, Professor Bouchard, because I'm aware of, at least in France, that you wouldn't be able to get antibiotics unless you've got a prescription. So certainly it's coming from prescribing, really, rather than self-treating. The picture might be a bit different in Spain. But the problem sort of with antibiotics that I always say, even in abscesses in patients, draining is usually what dentists would go for, and antibiotics are only reserved if there is a lot of infection in that abscess that needs to be drained, maybe by antibiotics, but they shouldn't be used on a routine practice. But you're the expert and you can correct me if I'm wrong. So I wouldn't expect a dentist to issue a fair bit of those, even if they were dealing with an abscess, because the idea is that they're the expert in draining it. So they shouldn't be needed any antibiotics unless you've got a high-risk patient, or you've got a bit of a more complex and necronization that you might need to back up with antibiotics.
Well, thank you so much for those insights. Very interesting points, definitely, since you're speaking about antibiotic stewardship, and a lot of relevant points to complement what has been shared during the presentations. As a sort of a wrap-up, I would like to remind you all that we had Professor Philippe with us. He spoke about the basics of gingivitis and periodontitis as well. He gave the floor also to the rest of our presentations, the second one from Dr. Zehra, about the association between periodontitis and non-communicable diseases. She also spoke about the burden of the disease in population, and we end up with asthma, speaking about the role of the pharmacist on community strategies, patient counseling, product recommendation, and also to how to integrate oral health recommendations into patient care routines. So that was very worthwhile. Again, thank you so much for our speakers. So I'll just kindly ask for the FIP staff just to showcase the last few slides of our presentation. That would be okay. So, this has been done. So to remind you all that you can actually check all future FIP digital events on events.fip.org. And then on the next slide, you'll see also some information about our annual Congress, which this year will be held in Cape Town from September 1st to the 4th, and the topic will be innovating for the future of healthcare. You will see shortly that the deadline to submit abscess is finished. The submission results will be announced in 1 month time, roughly. And then to remind you all that the early bird registration deadline would be, it's still 31st of May, 2024. Again, a big thank you to our speakers, a big thank you to the FIP and for the Turkish Pharmacy Association staff members who assisted us today. Thank you, Ines, Ali, Murat, and Aaron. One last thank you for your attendance and to our brilliant speakers. See you soon. Thank you so much.